In the first episode I made, I said that we will use Linux because it allows us to have a look at the Linux kernel source code. In this video, we will learn what syscalls are, and we will try to understand what user mode and kernel mode means by having a look at a specific kernel function copy from user. If you have ever wondered what it means to have an operating system in a more technical way, I hope I can show you some very interesting stuff. You may have seen pictures where it says user mode and kernel mode, or those circles with ring 0, ring 1 and so forth. They introduced this stuff in school, and even as a kid who knew programming, I had no imagination of what that actually means. You may even have heard that syscalls are an interface between those two worlds. So let's start by looking at what kind of syscalls exist. And again, you can read about syscalls in the Linux manual. So man syscalls. It says here that system call is the fundamental interface between an application and the Linux kernel. And system calls are generally not invoked directly, but rather via a wrapper function in glibc. Often the glibc wrapper function is quite thin, doing little work other than copying arguments to the right registers before invoking the system call. Invoking the system call. We will find out what that means soon. Further down, we can find a huge list of available system calls. I mentioned in an earlier video that the libc function printf is just a fancy wrapper around the syscall write. And you can see that when you use the program strace to trace all system calls. Instead of showing printf, it shows us write. The main page of write says it takes three parameters. First the file descriptor, then an address to a buffer and a count. So let's create a simple C program that calls this function. The first parameter is a file descriptor. We will talk about that value in another video, but we want it to be 1, which is the file descriptor for the standard output. For the second parameter, we want an address in memory that points to a string. We can simply write our string here. The compiler will find a place in memory for it and place the address of it here. And the last parameter will be the length. So, in our case, 5. Now open it in Radare with -d to debug it. And analyze all and seek to the main function. Then print the function and place a breakpoint at the right with db. Then dc to start the program and switch to a visual view with capital V exclamation mark. With s you can now follow this write function. We follow some weird stuff. This is the procedure linkage table, the PLT section. It's also sometimes called function trampoline. Again, a topic for another video. Now at some point we reach some more code. This is now the actual code from the libc library. And now we press s to step through this huge amount of code. I fast forward and cut a bit. There's so much stuff in this libc wrapper. But at some point, in the end, it reaches the interesting part. Here it is. It moves 1 into the EAX register and then comes the syscall instruction. A peek into the Intel assembler reference tells us that this is a fast call to privilege level 0 system procedures and has the opcode 0F05. It also says it does so by loading RIP from the IA32L* MSR. MSR stands for Model Specific Register. So like a jump that sets RIP to another value to continue execution somewhere else, it loads RIP from a model-specific register, MSR. The address was configured in this special register at some point during booting of the system through the WRMSR instruction. To use this function, you have to be in privilege level 0. So you cannot set this from a simple C program, because there you are in user mode, which is privilege level 3. And if you wonder now how you could get into level 0 from being level 3, then the answer is through an instruction like syscall. But then you cannot control what will be executed when you switch to level 0, because it will jump to a predefined address. So do you get now what it means to have different privilege modes, levels or rings? When you turn on your computer, the CPU starts in level 0. The kernel then configures stuffs like the AR32L* MSR register with an address through the WRMSR instruction, write MSR instruction. Then later drops privileges of the CPU to level 3. Now the hardware is kinda locked down. We cannot reconfigure this register. we cannot reconfigure the hardware. We can only enter level 0 again through a syscall. But we cannot control what will be executed because that address is fixed. Does that make sense? So anyway, let's come back to the syscall invocation. What we do is we load a number in a register. In our case, it was 1. And then we syscall to enter privilege level 0 by jumping to a fixed address in the kernel. And the kernel takes the number from the register, and it knows which syscall that is. So this nice table here shows us that the right syscall has the number 1. So the kernel knows from a table like this what it has to execute. And it's implemented in the source code file readwrite.c. And here it is. So this is what will be executed in the kernel when you invoke the right syscall. There's an awesome free book called Linux Device Drivers, which goes into great details how the kernel works, especially how to write a device driver and kernel modules. And in chapter 3, section 7, it reads, "The code for read and write in Scala needs to copy a whole segment of data to or from the user address space. This capability is offered by the following kernel function, which copy an arbitrary array of bytes and sit at the heart of most read and write implementations." So, first, what does user address space mean? Maybe when you debugged some programs with GDB, you wondered how it can be that every program seems to use the same addresses. Code is always at the same address. Stack is always at the same address. That doesn't make sense. How can all programs use the same address in memory? Wouldn't they overwrite each other? This is why we have a MMU, a memory management unit. The kernel sets up the MMU with special CPU instructions and configures registers and so forth. And this tells the MMU how to translate between virtual and physical addresses. So when you use the instruction move AAX and an address in your C program, the MMU will know how to translate this address for a given process to an actual physical address in your RAM. So it might request address 7F527320. But you don't have to care about that. The magic happens deep inside the hardware. This allows us to write programs without having to think about which addresses are still free. So, when you are in the kernel, after you have entered it with a syscall, you might want to copy some data from user address space, for example, to write it somewhere else. To do this, you can use the copy from user function. And I thought it might be an interesting function to trace through the kernel source code to get a feeling how the code of an operating system looks like. So let's use the Linux cross-reference, because it allows us to easily search for labels. So let's start by looking for the function copy from user, and we get a list with multiple places this function is defined. That is so weird. Why are there multiple places for that? Well, if you look closely at the file path, you will notice that each different CPU architecture has its own folder. So you can see here ARM for processors that you can find in your smartphone, or PowerPC, which is used by the PlayStation 3 on Nintendo Wii, and also x86, which is probably the architecture of your computer right now. So the code gets pretty crazy, and I don't know a lot about it, but let's just follow the main functions here and ignore the checks and stuff around it. So copy from user calls underscore copy from user. That function calls access OK on the from parameter, which is the address the user specified. In our case, the address of the string we wanted to write. And this checks if the particular process is allowed to read from that address. Imagine if a process tries to read some secrets from another process. And if everything is fine, it calls underscore underscore copy from user. Now it seems to split up in either 32-bit or 64-bit. And because we have a 64-bit Ubuntu Linux, let's follow that path. This looks like just a wraparound copy from user node check, indicating that the following functions won't check the access rights again. But luckily the kernel already did that. Okay, we follow that and we arrive at a pretty big function. So here's a big switch case statement, which seems to check the size we want to read from the user space. So let's say we just wanted to read 1 byte from user space. We would be in this case 1 here. So get user ASM is a preprocessor macro. This gets into how a C file is compiled in stages, But it actually is very simple. The statement is just a simple copy and replace. It means that this code that is defined here is just simply copied at the location it was used earlier. But before the compiler starts to compile the machine code. So you can basically also just treat it like a standard C function. And get user ASM defines some actual CPU instructions. And this move here is the instruction that moves data from the user space into a variable here. So I-type and R-type are from the parameters up here, and they were set to B for a single byte. In the way how those preprocessor statements work, you just replace this text with B. So the actual instruction would look like move B to 1. So this is AT&T assembler syntax, so it means it moves whatever 2 is into B1. Now this is C inline assembler syntax, and it refers to the variables that are defined down here. So percentage 2 refers to the third parameter, 0, 1, 2, which is the address we want to move data from. And we want to move it into percentage 1, which is X. And that is the location we want to move it to. The move is wrapped with STAC and CLAC, which stands for Set and Clear AC Register. And it has to do with SMAP, an anti-exploitation feature. And below the move, we see something with section fixup and assembler exception table that goes into how the kernel handles hardware exceptions. But there is a great documentation I found, and you can read what it does there exactly. Anyhow, as you can see, there was no code that would somehow translate the user supplied virtual address to a real physical address. It just executes a move. This is because the magic happens somewhere else. When the kernel executes this instruction, it will cause a page fault, because it tries to access a virtual address. And that is an interrupt, which means the CPU will jump to another predefined code location in the kernel, where this exception will be handled. Pretty similar how the syscall instruction made us jump to a predefined address. And in that page fault handler in the kernel, all the address magic with the MMU will happen. I will not go into that because it's already enough information for now. But I hope this random dive into the kernel code was interesting and maybe even eye-opening. So many smart people work together on creating such a complex and amazing platform. Almost makes me emotional thinking about how the media celebrates new iPhone apps while the real magic happens down here. Don't worry if you don't understand anything. Well, I even don't understand a lot of it. But it's important to just dive into some unknown stuff once in a while and get a first glimpse of what is out there. And I'm sure that at least subconsciously you now have a feeling for what it means to have a kernel. I also worry a bit that I may forget to explain certain things that seem clear to me, but you guys get lost. So please give me feedback on how the first couple of videos of the series were for you and what is still unclear, so I can improve and make content that helps as many people as possible.